Thank you. I call Mr. Gepp.
Thank you. Thank you, President. And following the previous speakers, it's an honour to rise in this place. And Mr. Rich Phillips is absolutely right. If ever you think that this is a forever gig, I invite you all, if you haven't, go and have a look at the transition plan that was set out by Parliament a few weeks ago, and just have a read through that. And the dates, you know, where it's very, very blunt about when you return your pass, when you return your computer, when you return your car, and when you turn into a pumpkin. So it's absolutely true, Mr. Rich Phillips. I couldn't concur any more with you that this isn't a forever gig. And I think it's fitting, President, that as the 2022 footy season concludes its business on Saturday, that this contribution also draws the curtain on my six footy seasons in this place. And I want to make some personal reflections about my time as an MP. And of course, I'll also say the appropriate thank yous. And in terms of the footy analogy, it's not lost on me, President, that as many of us rejoiced in that 1-point victory of the Sydney Swans on the weekend and the demise of Collingwood, there'll be some that won't be too upset to see me depart this show as well. And I wasn't sure whether when Mr. Atkinson was talking about standards in this place, if he was looking at me, and look, if I've offended anyone, well, I won't say I didn't mean it, because I think I probably did at the time, but I hope you didn't take it personally. Others who are leaving this place, President, and their role as an MP, have described it as their life's honour. And whilst I understand that sentiment, it's not one that I confess that's been for me in terms of being my life's honour. That's not to diminish in any way, shape or form the role that the Parliament or we as individual MPs play. It's been a magnificent highlight of my professional career, one of the many highlights in my professional career in the Labor movement, and it's certainly been an honour to represent the great Australian Labor Party and to serve the people of Northern Victoria. And, you know, sometimes you have to pinch yourself on some occasions to believe that you're in a particular room or a particular place or with a particular person or a group of people, or that you have the floor talking about the most remarkable issues. It can be breathtaking, as we know, and without a doubt it is a great privilege that only 128 Victorians get to experience every 4 years. I'm sure I probably haven't met the same array of people that Mr. Atkinson has mentioned, but I did meet one of the great presidents of our time, I think, Peggy O'Neill, last Friday. I actually had breakfast with Peggy along with Ms. Watt. So it does put you in places, in touch with some people that you do admire, and I absolutely agree with you that it is a great privilege to be able to do that. And I don't see it as... I've never seen it as, you know, the greatest honour of my life, because I think I see myself as part of the sum of a whole moving a wheel of people who make a contribution, you know, whether it's the clerks, whether it's the table office, whether it's security people, whether it's the IT people. Whoever it might happen to be, whether it's our constituents, whether it's the staff, the ministerial office, and we all play a role in this very complex and very intriguing and very interesting dynamic that is the Parliament of Victoria. And I'm pleased to have been able to play a part, absolutely. And I will cherish that. To the people of the Parliament, the staff. I've been around the public sector all of my life. You know, I started, you know, I've talked about Mr. Quilty and I are alumni from the tax office. 1981 is when I started in the tax office. So I've been around public service and public servants for all of my life. And I've got to say, and I think I said it yesterday when I tabled The SARC report, how blessed we are to have people of such an outstanding quality to provide the service. And people get to see the theatre and the show that we put on here from time to time. But it's it is the classic of the duck on the water and the legs underneath the water furiously going. And to all of you, I won't name you individually, you are marvellous people, and we owe you a debt of gratitude. On a professional level, I think the thing that will that I most cherish in my time in the labour movement is my time with my unions. I'm a trade unionist, and I spoke about that when I first came into to this place. And as I said, I've been a member. I joined the mighty CPSU. It wasn't the CPSU then, but it went through amalgamation. But I joined the union when I first started in the tax office, and that union gave me the greatest honour in my professional life when they made me a life member. And for people who come from trade union backgrounds, that is everything. That is the pinnacle. And in fact, the organiser who signed me up on my first day in the tax office went on to become my wife Sue is in the gallery. He was our best man, you know. So those friendships run deep and for a long time. After leaving the CPSU, I joined the FSU, and you know, I had a variety of jobs there, and it was a bit of a hodgepodge, really, and I'm not sure it really set me up for Parliament, but I did everything from run their policy and political program in addition to their front-end member engagement operations and administration. But I was popular back then, particularly in the ALP, because I actually was very instrumental in affiliating both the CPSU and the FSU to the Labor Party, so, and particularly in the left. I affiliated, you know, the people sort of scratched their head, really, a white-collar union such as the CPSU, and then butted it up with the FSU. So certainly the synergy between the work that I did in those days did carry on into this place. But it wasn't those unions that got me here, and I know this bloke will be watching, because the person who's responsible is a fellow by the name of Sean Reardon. Now, Sean was the Assistant Secretary of the CFMEU at the time, and I was at home on the back veranda having a cup of coffee on a Sunday morning. And Sean's number popped up on the phone, and I thought, oh, that's a bit interesting. What does Sean want on a Sunday? What on earth could be going on at the CFMEU? And I had no clue what he was about to say, but he said there was a vacancy about to come up in Parliament, and the CFMEU wanted direct representation in the Parliament, and that they wanted me to be their dog in the fight. And for those of you that know Sean, Sean's a very, very difficult man to say no to. But he's a beautiful man. I walked inside, and I must have had a look of fear on my face. I don't know, but Sue said, gee, what's happened? And I said, I think I just agreed to try and go into Parliament on behalf of the CFMEU. And, you know, life changed for a while after that. Sean has been nothing but absolutely supportive of me ever since that phone call, and he and his wife Brenda are very, very dear friends of Sue and I to this day. I love you, mate. Thank you. My next call was to my other great mate in the union movement, or one of my other great mates, the State Secretary of the FSU, Darren Martin. Funnily enough, Darren's now working for the CFMEU. Like Sean, Darren couldn't be any more supportive than he's been over the journey. And I'm thrilled to say that Darren and Jane remain lifelong friends of Sue and I. This government, I had no clue when I came into this place about the the reform. You know, when you're not in this place, you hear people talk about the government, you know, and often characterise the Andrews Labor government as the most progressive government in this this country. And they do that for a very good reason, because it is. And, you know, I've had to pinch myself on many, many occasions just thinking about the things that I've had the great privilege to be involved in as a member of the Labor Caucus, the Great Labor Caucus, a member of the Great Labor Australian Labor Party, and a member of the Andrews Labor Government. And it has been a tremendous honour. There are far too many achievements of this government for me to go across. I could have a crack if you want, but I think, given the time, I think people might... you want me to? You're okay. I've been encouraged to incorporate it into Hansard. So I won't go through. But it won't surprise anyone here, I don't think, that out of everything that I've had the privilege of seeing in this place and being a part of, nothing will top the big housing build. Nothing. So I'm not sure if I've told anyone in this place before, but I actually have a pretty deep connection with public housing. No, I do. And for me, and as I alluded in my inaugural, having affordable and secure housing is the most basic of human rights. Everything else is white noise. If you do not have decent housing, you've got nothing. And I was thrilled at the policy announcement when that great housing minister, and he will go down in the annals of Victorian history, I think, as and no disrespect to the current housing minister, of course, he'll forge his own path, but Richard Wynne will rightly be recognised in the history books of this state for the tremendous reform that he introduced into this parliament. And I was delighted that when Richard was making that announcement, that he also announced that 25% of the buildings, the dwellings, would be built in regional Victoria. So important, and I was delighted when I heard the current housing minister just earlier today update the House and the other chamber that we have to date built in excess of 6,300 of those new houses. So to Minister Wynne, now Minister Pearson, thank you from somebody who has lived it. It is so important. It is so important. And having started life in the... I had the opportunity earlier to bump into to Dick Wynne in Strangers, and I told him that having started life in the Flemington Public Housing Estate, and I wasn't certain a few days ago whether I'd actually be making a contribution this afternoon. I hadn't made up my mind, but... what made up my mind was I decided to go back to the old digs. I wanted to go back where it all began, you know. Holland Court, Flemington. Flat 4, 65. Proudly, it doesn't exist anymore. It's gone. That joint that I grew up in almost 60 years ago, thankfully, has now gone. But it's being rebuilt. It's being rebuilt. And some mum and dad and some other little boy and his big sister will get the chance to live in a place where it's safe, where it's warm, where it's sustainable. And I'm very, very proud of that. I'm very, very proud of that. If I can briefly talk about my electorate of Northern Victoria. The first thing I want to say about it, President, and excuse me for my language, but shit, it's big. It's 100,000 square kilometres. It's massive. And I feel very, very sorry for Jacqueline, for Tim, for Tanya, for Wendy. We should have 8 MPs in that electorate. It is that big. It is massive. And for anybody who's going to put their hand up, on the 25th of November, if you don't like driving, don't do it. Don't run for office because it's a big place. I reckon I passed Mike and Mel Leyland on the road at least 38 times. That was just in the first year. But of course, the best part of the job, as we all know, is the incredible people that you get to work with in your electorate. You know, we know that there are stars in this place, and there are, you know, and emerging stars, and people who make wonderful contributions and do wondrous things. But it's the folk out in the electorate, the people who roll their sleeves up, whether it's a footy canteen or whatever it is, who do so much. And before I mention, and I do want to mention just a couple of them, I do want to just generalise by thanking the 315,000 people in Northern Victoria who didn't vote for me. And I want to thank them because I reckon I met every one of them. One of the great things about having a regional electorate is that people look you in the eye and they'll tell you that they didn't vote for you. But they do it with good humour. They do it respectfully. Although I do have to say that on a couple of occasions, it was a bit disconcerting when, you know, you turn up to somewhere and it could be in the middle of nowhere, and believe me, middle of nowhere exists in certain parts of Northern Victoria, and you'd have some bloke sidle up to you and say, shit, mate, you're brave. We haven't seen a Labor member here for God knows how long. And you just wanted to make sure that the car was placed in a space where you can get out quickly. But they were fantastic. Everybody that I come across in Northern Victoria, they don't vote for you. We understand that, but they did do it respectfully and they did do it with a lot of humour. And 141,000 of them actually did vote for me. So there you go, you know, no one, you know, bugger John Snow being King of the North, you know. I have a couple of favourite projects that I do want to quickly mention, President, if I might. The Echuca Cancer and Wellness Centre, and there's a bit of a story, and I'll tell it very quickly behind this, because the board president, John Quirk, and the then CEO, Mike Delahunty, yes, of the famous Delahunty family, he was the CEO of Echuca Hospital. And not long after I started, Mike got me into the hospital for lunch. And he said, I want to show you around the hospital. I don't want any cameras there. You know, let's just do it one-on-one. I'll just show you that. And he took me to all it was terrific. You know, took me to all the shiny bits and showed it to me, and it was sensational. Then we went to his office in his boardroom. We had a beautiful lunch, and I said, mate, I've really got to go. And he said, yeah, your staff told me 5:15. It's 5:15. And I said, yes, yeah, that's right. And he said, I'll walk you out. And he walked me out, of course, through the worst part of the hospital, and it was the dialysis and oncology unit. We trudged up the stairs. We had to get up the stairs. I said, why are we walking up the stairs? And he said, because the lift's broken. So we had all of these cancer patients and people on dialysis having to... I was very, very proud when I came back to Parliament and got in touch with Minister Hennessy's office at the time and told her the story. And very proudly, in not too long a time, we were able to make an announcement of $6 million for an upgrade of that centre. the Cross and Vale Community Centre, Sheridan Clark, who runs that that community centre. You know, I got the pleasure of going there earlier this year and last year as well. We gave them a grant of $50,000, and you would have thought that we'd given them $50 million. You know, what an outstanding group of people that coalesce around that that Cross and Vale Community Centre. They are the real heroes of Northern Victoria. Shepparton Legacy. Look, there's too many stories about Shepparton Legacy, but I do want to single out Leonie Wilson, my friend Leonie Wilson, who I met Leonie at an Anzac Day. No, I think I think it was an Anzac Day function, and Leonie introduced me to five other women and this group of volunteers who had all been diagnosed with breast cancer very recently. And they decided that they could either wallow or they could band together and they could do something for their community. And they did. And they did. And they provide an excellent service for the people of Shepparton Legacy. And they do a power of work in their community. And Leonie, I don't know if you're watching, but if you are, love you. The two last ones, President, that I want to mention. These aren't big projects. These weren't big things that that happened outside of the Cancer and Wellness Centre at the hospital. These are just small things, but they mean so much. I wish I'd asked two people, Eva Gruen and Danny Finlay. They approached me. They'd come up with this this concept called I Wish I'd Asked. It was about connecting kids in secondary school with people in aged care. They were concerned about the loneliness being experienced in aged care. And we worked together and we got the grant up. I think it was about $125,000. And you've never seen bigger smiles on the faces of secondary students in the Shepparton area, particularly Wanganui. That's where most of the kids came from, and their connection with the people in that aged care facility was just a beautiful thing. Finally, the dearest project to my heart, Ardmona Primary. We had to. There were a number of announcements that we were making on a particular around a particular budget, and this little school, which is, you know, I don't know, Wendy, 15 k's out of Shep. I drove out there and knocked on the door of the principal and Jean Varty. And I said, oh, look at me. I've had one of those big cheesy checks, you know, that we're not allowed to use anymore. If anyone's got any use for about 30 of them, I've got them. You can have them. Said, you know, you've got a cheque for $15,000 or whatever it happened to be. And Jean was very, very grateful, very polite, but I sensed that there was something wrong. This little school has about two dozen kids, maybe 30 on their best day. And it was a beautiful old building, and I said to Jean, can you show me around, you know, if it's not too much, not too much trouble? And she wouldn't let me into this old building. Kept me away, and I thought, that's a bit odd. Anyway, I pressed the point, and it turned out that they had a rec room for the kids, and there was also a kitchen area with four stoves, and it used to be the place where they used to have breakfast club and teach the kids some life skills, because these kids all come from challenging backgrounds, and if not for that school, don't know what they'd be doing. And the roof was falling in. And the roof had been that way for some 18 months. And I said, well, and then I went out into the staff room. They got chicken wire on the bottom of the staff room door. What's the chicken wire for? Well, that's to keep the snakes out. And I'm thinking, gee, there's a few issues here. And fortunately, I want to thank James Molino, because I came back and I'd actually had to visit a few other schools that day in the area, and all of them said, oh yeah, we've got to close Ardmona down. And I thought, well, hang on. These kids, if they don't go to Ardmona, they're not going anywhere. I came back and I spoke to James about it, and worked with James over the next 12 months and his staff. And I'm so proud that I think it was 593,000, don't quote me, but somewhere in that sort of vicinity. And if you want to have a look at what this school's like now, go on and Google Ardmona Primary School, and now they've now become a school of choice in the area. And I'm most proud of that project out of everything else I've done. President, I know I've gone on, and I said I wouldn't, but this is the last time, so, you know, just a little bit more. I hope that I've been true to my values in this place. I've tried my best to let them guide me. Sometimes they've got me into trouble. I'll grant you that. But repercussions of standing up for my values and my friends was never important to me. It never bothered me that there may have been some repercussion for me, that there might be a cost. That didn't matter. My values are my values, and it's who I am. As most of you know, I've had a bit of a perilous journey over the last 3 years, health-wise. And I've got to say, on more than one occasion, Sue and I weren't quite sure about whether we were going to get through it, you know. Things got a bit hairy. In fact, what saved me, I'll tell you the full story one day, but when Martin Foley stood up last year and announced that there were going to be some restrictions on critical care, that actually saved me. I was on the table at the time and about to undergo a 10-hour operation, and they pulled the pin on it and said, well, we'll try something else, and something else seems to have worked. So, touch wood, thanks, Marty. I appreciate your intervention. And it meant a lot to me, President, that there were some times I couldn't rise to the challenge. Try as I might, I couldn't answer the bells. That didn't sit well with me. It didn't sit well with me. Because we do have a responsibility in this place, and you should make every effort. And there were other days, of course, where I shouldn't have been here, that I was able to make it and drag myself over the line. So, and I want to thank all of my colleagues who knew that there were just times where I couldn't do it, that I'd try, but I'd leave a gap, and it might not, you know, it might just happen at a moment's notice. So thank you for picking up the slack. Thank you. I also want to particularly acknowledge the opposition who are aware of the circumstances. Pairing at the time was still a bit of a prickly issue in this place. But I've got to say that Mr. Finn and Mr. Ondaatje reached out to me on behalf of the opposition and said, we will always grant you a pair. And that meant a lot. It meant a lot. It gave us a lot of comfort, Sue and I, that if I couldn't answer the bell, you know, the team wouldn't be punished because I couldn't get to the line. So thank you. Very quickly, President, I want to thank my staff. They're not here. I didn't decide until very late that I was going to do it. I know that they're a bit pissed off that, you know. I didn't forewarn them so that they could come in. But to Anthony, Zainab, Jamie, Leela, Darren, Kate, you're wonderful people, and very lucky to have you. And I promise that I'll buy you lunch, and it might go for a few hours. Can I thank all of the branches, the ALP branches across my electorate of Northern Victoria, for your support and for the support that you've given Jacqueline and I it was never geographically easy for us to get to all of those meetings, and we thank you for your understanding. My mate Jane, she's not here. We made a pact that we would do this together. Unfortunately, we're not able to do that. It would be remiss of me not to mention her on today. I've said a lot about her over the last 2 months. I thank the family for giving me that that opportunity. And yet, it doesn't matter how many times I speak about it; it always seems to be insufficient. Friends for life, President. Sometimes in life you really get lucky, and Mr. Barton said it earlier in an earlier contribution that new friendships get struck up in this place and that they will endure, and they will, absolutely they will. And in addition to those new friendships, I also gained two brothers for life. My two Lebanese mates, Nazir and Caesar. You have, you know what you've done, and I love you for it. To the Labor Caucus, the broader Labor Caucus, current and future, I wish you well. Only a Labor government can deliver the sort of life that I think our citizens, our children need and deserve, and I wish you nothing but success. And if I can, in any way, shape or form, turn a vote, then I'll turn a vote. I'll give it a crack. To my family, none of us can do this work without the support of our family. And I've had unwavering support from my kids, Amanda and Daniel, and thank you and I love you. My biggest family support has come from a little mate who I know is watching through that camera. And we had a bit of a game that we'd play over the last six footy seasons where, you know, I'd scratch my nose if I was up on my feet and, you know, he'd know that that was for him. Landon. Don't have to do that today. He gave me a little photo frame. On Father's Day. Because he's with his mum and only his mum. He gave me a frame. And on its title was Best Mates. And it was the best gift I've ever got. And the best thing that I'm going to do after this, Landon, is I'm going to spend so much more time with you, mate. To my beautiful wife, Sue. Sue and I first went out on the 16th of February, 1983. It's embedded in my brain. And for all of that time, it's been about unions and politics, campaign after campaign. Now, Sue, I don't propose to put you through another 40 years of me. I don't think anyone deserves that, but I do promise that now is your time. I love you. Finally, President, solidarity forever, and Khan the Tigers.